And the next item of business is a statement from Ivan McKee on an update on Dell historical industrial transaction. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on the Minister for around 10 minutes, Mr McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, in 2016, faced with the potential permanent closure of the last remaining steel plant in Scotland and the loss of hundreds of highly skilled jobs, the Scottish Government took action to support the purchase of the rolling mills at Dell and Clydebridge. Many members will remember that Long Steel had owned the businesses. Tata Steel UK had taken these over from Longs, and following difficulties due to energy prices and feasible margins, Tata Steel UK Limited had mothballed the plants in 2015 and were seeking to find an alternative operator of the business. In order to facilitate the sale and to ensure the continued operation of this important industrial asset for Scotland, the Scottish Government took ownership of the business for a short period of time while it transferred from Tata Steel UK to Liberty House Group, part of GFG Alliance, who continue to this day to operate the rolling mill. This transaction back in 2016 was a unique and unprecedented economic intervention by the Scottish Government. The agreement to facilitate the transaction was concluded over a period of days in March 2016, while Parliament was in the pre-election recess. In my statement today, Presiding Officer, I will provide a point of clarification in terms of one aspect of the agreement between the Scottish Government and Tata Steel UK Limited. But before I do, I will provide some further background to the transaction. Earlier in 2016, the employees of the rolling mills in the Lanarkshire steel communities left their work to start Christmas holidays in the knowledge they had been made redundant going into January 2016, with the prospect of a future for the steel industry in Scotland looking very bleak. Only a handful of the people in the plant remained for health and safety reasons. There had been excellent collaborative work from members across the chamber, trade unions and local authorities to support the steel task force. And despite the apparent lack of investors in the Scottish steel plants, the steel task force committed to leaving no stone unturned to find a positive outcome to the potential demise of the Lanarkshire mills. There are currently around 140 people now employed at DL and Clydebridge. The Scottish Government's intervention resulted in the continuation of steel production and skilled employment at Liberty Steel DL. It was a detailed and complex negotiation that led to the transfer of the ownership of the plants to a business that has since supported the workforce and ensured the continued manufacture of high-quality steel slab products from the Lanarkshire rolling mill. The matter that I bring to the Chamber today concerns one particular point within the contract. I wish to explain the issue, the work being done by the Scottish Government to clarify this with the businesses involved, and importantly to assure the people of Scotland and this Parliament that the decision to facilitate the continued manufacture of steel in Scotland was the correct thing to do. The steel industry across the UK and globally has faced many challenges in recent years. I set out in this chamber on 24 March 2021 the collapse of Greensill Capital Finance House, a major financier of the GFG Alliance, had highlighted a risk to the steel industry in Scotland. Ministers over this year have previously advised the Parliament of our continued work to retain and support the economic opportunities that the Lanarkshire steel mills provide. I have met with local elected members to keep them informed of the work being done to protect the steel industry in Scotland. Officials have been working to better understand the Scottish Government's position in respect of the GFG Alliance, as would be expected given the jobs at stake and support previously provided. It was during a detailed review of the previous transaction to inform the contingency work that officials discovered a detail that would need to be considered by the companies involved. It's also important to note that whilst there is ongoing monitoring of the situation across the current businesses in Scotland, as I know we are aware that the UK Government has also been active in as part of the wider GFG Alliance activity at the larger plants in other parts of the UK. There has not been a request for support from the Alliance. The businesses in Scotland still continues to operate and produce under challenging circumstances, and that, Presiding Officer, is a credit to the Scottish workforce. On 24 March 2016, Tata Steel UK and Liberty House agreed for the Scottish Government to act as an intermediary between the companies to facilitate a sale of the plants from Tata Steel UK to Scottish Government, who would immediately sell the sites to Liberty House. There is one specific part of the contract arrangement that has arisen during our contingency work that we are advised may not comply with state aid rules. This clause granted an enduring indemnity from Scottish ministers to Long Steel, whereby Scottish ministers would be liable to cover the cost of certain liabilities arising from the Tata Steel ownership of the Lanarkshire plants. It is important also to ensure the Chamber are aware that there has been no call on this indemnity to date, and the circumstances where this would have been called upon are, in our view, unlikely to materialise. At the time of the deal, a parent company guarantee was signed with Liberty House, meaning that if part of the company at Liberty Steel DL ceased to exist, then the liabilities would pass to the wider group. I would reiterate, though, that our contingency planning and recent reports on the wider group have highlighted that the Lanarkshire plant is operating well, considering the current conditions they have faced. If the wider group fails to exist and the site is going to be repurposed to a different use, then some of those liabilities for environmental remediation may then crystallise to the operators of the site currently and to any previous operator of the site. Many varying factors would need to happen before such a scenario would come to fruition. It was, however, imperative that, having identified this clause was no longer valid, I made the relevant business and the Chamber aware of the situation. Also, the Chamber will want to note that no money has been paid or will be paid under this contract by the Scottish Government beyond the £1 paid to purchase the business that was immediately recouped upon its sale. In 2016, the contractual negotiation was proceeding at pace in a highly pressured commercial environment, with our aim being to save a totemic Scottish industry, an aim in which we were successful. It was not our intention to sign to a contract clause which may not comply with state aid requirements. The conclusion reached on state aid, based on advice at the time, was different to what I've outlined today, and we decided that we were able to proceed at that time with the transaction. We have informed Tata Steel, as members around the Chamber would expect. We have ensured that they have been provided notice of this statement to allow them to consider any commercial implications for their business. As a global business, we also needed to ensure that they had time to notify their head office in Mumbai. It is understandable that they will need time to reflect and consider their position. We will continue to have supportive dialogue with Tata, and the company have access to our officials as they require. We have also formally informed Audit Scotland and will be taking steps to communicate with Liberty Steel UK and the European Commission through the relevant UK Government Department. I would summarise, Presiding Officer, that the detailed analysis of commercial interventions taking place now demonstrates that this Government will always do its very best to ensure that any agreements we enter into are the right ones. My officials will work with stakeholders to go into further detail and analyse any lessons that should be learnt. I opened my statement by acknowledging the collective efforts across the Chamber back in March 2016 to ensure that steel communities in Scotland had a future. Today, high-quality steel products continue to be produced in Lanarkshire. Skilled manufacturing employment continues, which would not have been the case without our intervention. It was our assessment at the time that this was the best way to ensure the reopening of the plants, to secure a key Scottish industrial asset for the future, and ensure Scotland's steel industry did not fall silent. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we will need to move on to the next item of business. I'd be very grateful if members that want to ask a question could press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function if they're joining us remotely. And I call question number one, Jamie Halker-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement. Both in this session and the previous session, I've questioned the Ministers on the issue of transparency around the Scottish Government's exposure in the form of guarantees and support to the GFG Alliance. We've seen the extended attempts by the Financial Times newspaper to access what should have been relatively straightforward figures for the Government. The taxpayers' exposure relating to the Lochaber operations, as some we discovered, amounted to some £586 million. And now in today's statement, we've seen the Scottish Government appear to be themselves unaware of their own commercial exposure to these operations in Lanarkshire. and have been advised that their arrangements rushed through ahead of the elections in May 2016, with Parliament unable to scrutinise but ministers able to make political capital out of the deal, may be unlawful. And so can I ask the Minister, when was the Scottish Government first advised that their agreement might not comply with state aid rules? How much of the potential liabilities the Scottish Government are exposed to in this deal, and how long will those exposures remain? And will the Minister, recognising that for this Chamber to have any confidence in the transparency or even the clarity of the Scottish Government's agreements here, will he agree to full transparency into the Scottish Government's relationship with GFG Alliance and commit to make available to MSPs any information relating to these agreements?
Minister.
Well, first point to make is that there are no exposures to the Scottish Government as a consequence of what I've outlined today. The second point to make is that, of course, we're committed to full transparency within the limits of legal advice and commercial sensitivity, and will continue to be so. Third point I would make is that, with regards to LICABR, this statement I'm making today has no bearing on LICABR, which was a completely separate transaction. And the point I would also make is that the numbers that the member quotes with regards to the Scottish Government exposure, he'll be well aware, because that information has also been made available, that is more than covered by the assets that the Scottish Government has security with regards to LICABR. So there is no exposure to the Scottish Government with regards to that transaction, without regards to that transaction either. And the final point I would make is that the Scottish Government, yes, we moved this transaction through at pace in March 2016. That wasn't as a consequence of the election timetable, as the member is perhaps implying. It was absolutely as a consequence of needing to move fast to secure that commercial deal to save those jobs. It was the commercial reality we faced at that time. It's something, frankly, that we're proud that we did in order to save those jobs and save the Scottish steel sector. And it was the right decision at that time, and continues to be so. There's still a steel sector in Scotland. People are still employed. High-skilled jobs are still employed in that sector in Scotland. And as I made very clear, there is no exposure to the Scottish Government as a consequence of my statement today and the actions we took at that time.
I encourage members to ask their question and then listen to the responses. Question number two, Daniel Johnson.
Noted, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin by reminding the Chamber of my register of interest? I'm a member of Community, the trade union that represents steel workers, and I thank the Minister for advance sight of his notice, of his statement. Can I ask, despite the Government acknowledging that it broke the law, that there is no implication for the security of the 140 jobs on that site, that's perhaps the most important question. But from one former business person to another, can we maybe put this into plainer terms? What are we talking about? Is the Government saying that if GFG and Liberty House were to collapse, it would have to pay the clean-up costs? And if so, what would that bill be? Because the clean-up cost for Ravenscraig was £70 million 20 years ago. And given that it has written this indemnity, that there is a theoretical liability for that, is there any obligation whatsoever for Tata to rescind that? The Scottish Government may have broken the law, but there's no obligation on Tata to let them off the hook, is there? And finally, can I ask about process? When did this come to light? Because I don't believe the Minister answered that important question from Jamie Halcrow-Johnson. And how is this possible, that such an important deal could get through government due diligence and not have spotted the fact that it breaks the law?
Minister.
In terms of the timing point, there was a number of questions from Jamie Halcrow-Johnson. We've been looking at this through the course of the past months as a consequence of the situation evolving with GFG, to understand what we may need to do to be involved to save those jobs should a difficult situation transpire. And as I said in my statement, it's all credit to the workforce at the site that the plant continues to operate successfully in the face of significant challenges. There's clearly a very complex situation that had to be worked through, and advice taken as to the situation with regard to where we are just now. That process has been worked through in due course, and as we become a achieve clarity on that situation and taking the relevant advice, we are now bringing forward this statement to provide transparency to the Parliament and others as to the current situation. With regards to the situation with regards to liability, the whole point of the statement is that that is not the case. There is no liability as a consequence of the current position to the Scottish Government, and I made that very clear. Made that very clear in my statement.
Question number 3, Claire Adamson, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Tess White.
As a member of the Steel Task Force, which of course was a cross-party endeavour, I'm aware how vital it was to save the jobs in both the steel mills at DL and Clyde Bridge. Steelmaking is synonymous with my constituency of Motherwell and Wishaw. What impact, if any, will the substance of the statement today have on the ongoing Liberty Steel operation at DL and Clyde Bridge and the 140 jobs still protected by the deal made by the Scottish Government?
Minister.
Thank you. The member by Wales, 140 people employed that at the sites. Jobs that would not have existed if the Scottish Government had not intervened and protected the sector. And there are many jobs in the supply chain, in the wider community, obviously, that are supported as a direct and indirect consequence of that. And the statement today makes absolutely no impact on that. Those jobs are continue to operate as long as the plant continues to operate. And as I've said, I've been working closely with the officials working on a very, very regular basis, and I'm engaged very regularly as well with the business and with local members and trade unions and others to understand the latest position there. And the business continues to operate successfully, and the Scottish Government is very engaged to understand what we need to continue to do to ensure that continues to be the case, because we are committed to the sector in Scotland. And for clarity, the statement today makes absolutely no impact on that situation at all.
Tess White, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, this afternoon's statement says the Scottish Government officials will work with stakeholders to analyse any lessons that should be learned. Given the lack of transparency around this agreement, can the Minister confirm which stakeholders will be involved in this process and whether the findings will be shared fully and expeditiously with the Parliament and the wider public?
Minister.
Well, I would think by virtue of the fact we're making this statement today, it talks to the fact that we are committed to transparency on this situation and continue to be so. We will look at the internal processes with regard to the decisions that were the conclusions that were arrived at in 2016 and why they differ from the conclusions that we've arrived at this point in time, and the advice, and I've said within the restrictions placed on us with regards to disclosure of legal advice and commercial sensitivity, we will make available the information as necessary to ensure full transparency with the Parliament beyond. And in terms of engagement with stakeholders, I've already made clear we engage with the full range of stakeholders on a regular basis, including the GFG group, including Tata with regard to this particular issue, including local members, including trade unions, and including others in the local community and the wider industry that have an interest in matters and an interest in the Scottish Government's continued support to ensure that the jobs at the steel plants in Lanarkshire continue to be in place.
Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Richard Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Having worked at DL 35 years ago and Clyde Bridge briefly before that, I was heartened that the Scottish Government acted to save the remains of an industry that lost 16,000 jobs in Scotland in the 70s under Labour and 10,000 in the 80s and 90s under the Tories. Can I ask the Minister, in addition to the 140 direct jobs, how many people are working in the supply chain whose jobs have been saved by the actions of the Scottish Government? And I'm interested in you answering this question from myself, because it's clear that the opposition aren't interested in that particular
Minister.
Question.
Minister.
Thank you. And to be honest, I find it hard to believe that that Kenny Gibson could have, he must have had his short trousers on when he was working there 35 years ago. So yeah, I commend him for his efforts as a youngster in supporting Scotland's steel sector. Yeah, there are, as identified, 140 direct jobs, but many jobs in the supply chain and in the wider communities that are dependent on the continued operation of the plants at DL in Clydebridge. And the Scottish Government, as I say, has committed the actions we have taken to take forward these complex transactions to make sure that the deals could go through to ensure that the sector was saved are absolutely the right thing to do. And we see great opportunities for the sector as we move into an environment where the net zero economy becomes more significant, and there's conversations ongoing with the planet about how they can take advantage of that and continue to innovate and provide a strong future for those plants and the changing steel sector as it evolves rapidly at this point in time.
Thank you. Question Richard Leonard, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I begin by referring members to my register of interests and say that I was also a member of the Scottish Steel Task Force, and my first priority is saving these jobs. We know that Green Steel Capital has collapsed with losses of £1 billion, and we know that the GFG Alliance is under investigation by the Serious Fraud Office. We know as well that Audit Scotland will tomorrow publish its audit of the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts. Is that why this statement has been rushed out to Parliament today?
Minister.
The member is absolutely correct in terms of the focus being on saving those jobs, and that remains the priority. And I'm proud to say we've been successful in that, and people are in work over the last 5 years that otherwise wouldn't have been the case. And I've answered members previously. The bringing forward of this statement is to ensure transparency to the Parliament. It's a complex situation. We've been working on it as a consequence of the evolving situation at GFG, which has led us to have a look at all possible scenarios in terms of what may unfold as a consequence of that. Thankfully, despite the difficulties with Greensill, the GFG business continues to operate, and the management team at the Lanarkshire plants continue to produce high quality product and sell into what is currently a strong market for their products, and we continue to engage very, very closely with them. But in terms of the time, and it's as a consequence of us having worked through these very complex situations over the course of the last months, understood the situation as it transpired, and as a consequence of looking at that scenario planning in detail as to what the future might hold, and looking at previous transactions as a consequence of that, led us to have a complete review of all the work that was done in 2016. And coming out of that work, there some questions were asked, which we then took forward to take expert advice on to understand the implications of that. And as a consequence of that, that's why we're bringing forward this statement today, which I reiterate has no bearing on liabilities to the Scottish Government as a consequence of what I've said today.
Thank you, Minister. I'm going to have to ask you to be a bit more succinct in your responses. Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Whilst the Scottish Government's actions to save the Clydebridge and DL plants have been very welcome, members of the public will want to know that this has come at good value to taxpayers. For the sake of clarity, can the Minister provide assurances that the contract has come at no cost to the Scottish taxpayer?
Minister.
Yes, I can confirm that. The Scottish Government incurred no upfront costs from this transaction. I said we paid £1 for it and got that money back. And Scottish Government's officials supported work to complete this transaction as part of their normal range of duties. And the news, as I've said earlier, that I'm sharing with Parliament today does not create any financial liability for the Scottish Government. Does not create any financial liability for the Scottish Government.
Thank you. Willie Rennie, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Colin Beattie. I think we'll go to Colin Beattie and come back to Willie Rennie if we can sort out the link. Colin Beattie.
Can the Minister provide any further information as to the latest assessment which has been made as to the productivity of the Lanarkshire plant?
Minister.
Thank the member for a very important question, because the plant will obviously survive based on its ability to be able to sell into the steel market. Officials, as I said, meet regularly with local management team, and it's heartening to see that even during current challenging circumstances, they're continuing to operate and produce high-quality steel plate, and steps are continuing to be taken to increase the productivity of the operation in the Lanarkshire plant, something that the Scottish Government is hugely supportive of and something I am kept updated on a regular basis.
Gather there's still an issue with Mr Rennie's connection, so we'll go to Maggie Chapman, who also joins us remotely. I think we've lost all of the connections. So we'll go to Liz Smith, who joins us in person.
I'm here. Minister, I've listened very carefully to the answers that you gave to Jamie Halcrow-Johnson and to Daniel Johnson, and I didn't hear, I don't think, what they were asking for, which is, when did you actually find out when there had been a breach of the contract? When did you actually find that out?
Minister.
As I thought, I've been very clear, this has been a process of working through a range of questions and then seeking clarification on the implications of that. We started earlier this year, in the light of the GFG situation, to assess the current situation at DL, what the implications of that might be, what some scenario planning could look like as a consequence of that, and also had a look back through all the previous transactions that took place in 2016 as a consequence of that. Through the course of that work, a number of issues were raised that we looked at and discussed those with expert advice to understand the implications of them. Clearly, we've had to have discussions back and forward to understand what the implications of those are, to seek clarification on what is a very, very complex transaction. And we have brought this statement to the Parliament as soon as we have brought this statement to Parliament as soon as we become clarified the situation with regards to the questions we had to ask on that advice, and were able to articulate a statement which took into account all of that advice, ensuring all of our questions had been asked and answered, and we had complete clarity on what the situation was. I think members wouldn't expect us to come with a statement that was half-baked, where we hadn't asked the questions. We just became aware of this.
Excuse me, Minister. Members are now shouting, who weren't even in for the statement. So can I ask Mr Kerr in particular, please, to pipe down and listen to the response from the Minister.
We have brought this statement to the Parliament as soon as we've clarified the questions we had drawn about that advice, to be sure that what we're bringing to the Parliament today was a robust statement that took into account all the factors and all the information available at this time.
We still appear to be having connection problems, so I call Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a representative of a constituency with a proud steelwork heritage, including the Gartcross finishing mill closed in 1986 to a huge public outcry, I can confirm I was only six at the time, but my grandad did work there. Can the Minister provide any further detail as to the Scottish Government's latest engagement with the steel sector stakeholders regarding the challenges and opportunities that the sector faces in order to help ensure a healthy future for steel in Scotland?
Minister.
I thank the member for the question. The Scottish Government, as I said earlier, is hugely focused on understanding how the sector is evolving, and we watch that very closely. I'm a member of the UK Steel Council, which includes all the major steel producers across the UK, and is chaired by Secretary of State for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy. And there are huge opportunities for the steel sector and the move to a net zero economy. Zero Waste Scotland is looking at the circular opportunities for the energy transition in Scotland, and their report, How Should Scotland Manage Scrap Steel, speaks into that space. And it's the first in a series of reports that are producing. I very much welcome the work being done by Zero Waste Scotland and others in this area, and look forward to seeing the follow-up reports will help inform our policy going forward. And it's very timely, given the emphasis from COP26 in helping energy-intensive industries like the steel sector as they move towards net zero.
Thank you. I'm informed that Maggie Chapman now joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Minister for the sight of his statement. We know that steel has been an important part of Scotland's industrial landscape, providing jobs and materials much needed in our economy. And I echo his remarks about the resilience of the workforce. Given the issues surrounding GFG Alliance, as others have already mentioned, and the high carbon nature of the steel industry, can the Minister outline what role he expects the steel industry to play in Scotland's future, and how we can ensure that we retain the skills and expertise of the workforce in Scotland's industrial future?
Briefly, please, Minister.
Absolutely. Very good question. Thank the Member for that. Clearly, as I said, with regards to GFG, we're watching that situation very closely and running extensive scenario planning on how we may be able to respond to any developments. But in terms of our point about the sector, of course, we absolutely understand the energy-intensive nature of the sector. There's a huge commitment within the sector in Scotland, across the UK and internationally, to move towards a net-zero future and to decarbonise steel production, and the creation of green steel has a huge focus, something we're very supportive of and engage very closely with. And I think a just transition for this sector to ensure the workers continue to be engaged in producing high-quality green steel in the future is something that we are very focused on delivering for the workers, the community and across Scotland.
And finally, Willie Rennie. Willie Rennie, can you hear us? That answers that question. Unfortunately, we will need to pause briefly before moving on to the next item of business.